We begin with incredible news out of Wisconsin. Jamie Kloss, the teenager who went missing after her parents were murdered, has been found alive. CBS's Mark Liverman has the details.
Nearly 3 months after she went missing, 13-year-old Jamie Kloss has been found alive. The Wisconsin teenager was last seen October 14th at a family member's birthday party. Early the next morning, a garbled 911 call was made from her mother's cell phone. When police arrived at the Kloss home about 4 minutes later, they say Jamie was gone and her parents were found dead. Yesterday afternoon, Jamie turned up 65 miles north of her barren Wisconsin home. CBS station WCCO spoke to the woman who found her. She says she was just walking her dog when Jamie approached her and said she needed help. According to authorities, a suspect was taken into custody 11 minutes later. Jamie's aunt Sue Allard spoke to WCCO.
Oh my gosh, I don't know. There was rumors earlier today, and I prayed and prayed they were true and they come to not be true, and I just shut myself totally down because I thought today was going to be the day. And then to find out 2 hours later that she was found, I just cannot believe this.
Allard says her niece is recovering in the hospital. In the weeks that followed her disappearance, thousands of volunteers canvassed miles of fields, forests, and more in search of the young girl. Jamie's family never gave up hope.
We all love you to the moon and back, and we will never stop looking for you.
Yesterday, Barron County Sheriff Chris Fitzgerald wrote on Facebook, "We promise to bring Jamie home," and tonight we get to fulfill that promise. Mark Liverman, CBS News.
The Barron County Sheriff's Office will hold a news conference later this morning at 11 a.m. Eastern. Also making this morning's headlines, hundreds of thousands of federal workers will miss their first paychecks today as the partial government shutdown enters day 21. On Thursday, President Trump spent the day in Texas along the U.S.-Mexico border to push for his border wall. The president says he could declare a national emergency to divert Pentagon funds for the wall and says he'll see what happens in the next few days. Here in Montana, Senator Scott Sayles' proposal to send $8 million of Montana money to fund the border wall is drawing ire from Governor Steve Bullock. Previously, Sayles acknowledged that Governor Steve Bullock might not agree and could veto the measure, but said it's still something he wants to pursue. And on Thursday, Governor Bullock, a Democrat, made it clear that he's not on board for spending state money on a border wall. Bullock told reporters at the Capitol he has plenty of respect for Senator Sayles and complimented him for running the Senate with great integrity and transparency. But he said it's puzzling that Sayles would propose spending state money on a construction project in California when he's rarely supported infrastructure investments here in Montana.
$8 million is significant. $8 million is a third of the costs of what the state share of Medicaid will be. $8 million can do incredible work for local infrastructure in communities all across our state. So I don't think that it makes a lot of sense to use Montana taxpayer dollars on federal projects.
Sayles, a Republican from Bozeman, told MTN News Wednesday he believes Montanans support Trump's proposed border wall. He said $8 million would just be Montana's tiny share of the cost to help get the project going and maybe break a stalemate that has shut down the federal government. His proposal has yet to be introduced. Meanwhile, Montana Democrats have announced they will sponsor their own bill to extend Montana's Medicaid expansion program. Lawmakers made the announcement at a Capitol news conference on Thursday and said putting the bill together will be a group effort. Representative Mary Cafaro of Helena said she will request the bill, which will extend Medicaid expansion indefinitely. The program that provides government-funded health coverage to about 95,000 low-income adults is set to expire in June. Republicans who control the legislature say they'll likely support extending the program, but they also say they want to add some reforms and target the program more at the truly needy. GOP Representative Ed Buttry of Great Falls said this week he's working on a bill that will extend and reform the program. Members of the Northern Cheyenne tribe have selected a new president and vice president. In Thursday's special election, Rindalia Whiteman Pena won the election for president, and Winfield Russell will serve as the vice president. The winners will fill the seats left by Jace Kilsback, who resigned as president in October, and Conrad Fisher, who resigned as vice president. Kilsback stated in a letter that he resigned because of clashes with the legislative branch. Fisher cited health reasons for his resignation. Pena and Russell will serve out the terms, which expire in November of 2020. The man who was found guilty of murdering former Bighorn County Sheriff William Joy is set to learn his fate later today. On June 10th, 58-year-old Donald Gray Jr. approached Joy at knife point at a Billings post office. He then forced Joy to drive him away from the building, continuing to threaten him with the knife. When Joy tried to signal for help near Lewis and Clark Middle School, Gray stabbed him to death. Prosecutors previously hoped for life in prison. A one-time federal agent here in Billings is indicted on child pornography charges. 48-year-old Sean Conrad is charged with sexual exploitation of a child and possession of child pornography. In August, Conrad allegedly attempted to entice a minor to engage in sexually explicit content. Court documents state Conrad did this for the purpose of producing visual depiction of such content. Conrad was employed as a special agent with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service in the Billings region, but it is unclear whether or not he was employed here at the time of the incident or if he is still employed in this region. If convicted, Conrad faces a minimum of 15 years, but up to 50 in prison. A special talk on human trafficking was held last night here in Billings. The co-founder of the Organization for Prostitution Survivors says if there are no buyers of prostitution, then there's no business. He says many prostitutes start as teens who are abused and are vulnerable to pimps and their customers. He has also worked with men who have been convicted of buying sex.
It's called a trick because he's paying for the illusion of consent. He's paying for the illusion that she wants to be with him. And in reality, it's probably one of the last things that she wants to do. But for some reason, right, she needs to get this money. And so if we are serious, once again, you know, about gender equality, we need to approach this from the demand side, from those who have the power to make a real choice about whether this is going to happen or not.
The Yellowstone County Area Human Trafficking Task Force held last night's talk. In Helena, as most Montanans know, the state capitol is home to the legislature, the governor's office, and the office of the Secretary of State. It also showcases some of the state's most impressive tributes to its people and heritage. MTN's John Riley reports.
The Montana State Capitol holds a total of 34 murals and 8 sculptures honoring the state's people. During the construction of the building, the state's founders intended the design and interior to reflect the values and aspirations of the Treasure State.
They were very insistent that they wanted Montana's history portrayed, that they wanted important aspects of Montana's story on the walls and displayed in a manner that everyone could understand.
Watching over the rotunda are 4 archetypal figures representing the roles of the first Montanans.
Governor Toole gave specific instructions. The Indian chief, for example, is Chief Charlo, a Salish chief who resisted removal of his people from the Bitterroot. For the cowboy, Toole didn't say a specific cowboy. He just said, look at the work of Charlie Russell. He knows cowboys and that's what you want to do.
A decade later, Russell's work would be added to the Capitol. In the House chambers is the cowboy artist's largest work ever produced. Standing 20 feet tall and 25 feet wide, the painting depicts Lewis and Clark meeting the Salish Indians at Ross Hole.
The title says it's about Lewis and Clark. The painting is really about the Indians, and what a majestic statement that is about the importance of Montana's first inhabitants.
Most recent additions to the Capitol were dedicated in 2015 and depict the women who built Montana.
It's not about just the few people we think of as being exceptional. We have Jeanette Rankin statue down there, that's great. But the history of Montana is made up of the history of really ordinary people doing ordinary things, whether that's homesteading, whether that's starting a small business and running it as we see here. Those are the activities that make Montana what it was and what it is and what it will be in the future.
Governor Joseph Toole said, "The Capitol will be to the state what the homestead is to the citizen, what the fireside is to the family." The artwork of the Capitol serves as more than mere decoration. It preserves the ideals and hopes of Montanans in the People's House. In Helena, John Riley, MTN News.
Now back here in Billings, the century-old downtown St. Francis School will likely have a new owner and some potential growth around it. Harrison Fagg, who developed the Granite Tower, and his son Russ, who is a former Billings District Judge, plan to purchase the building. Russ Fagg tells Q2 there was a lot of history and a lot of memories in the walls of the old school, which is why his plans are to keep it as is. Despite needing a few updates and repairs on the exterior, they don't plan on any major changes. The plan is to lease the rooms inside as office space, but Fagg says they are also open to buyers if someone was interested in owning some space inside.
Well, the building's 100 years old, and we think it's a really nice looking building. It's a really solid building. There's not a crack in the foundation. And so, God willing, we can have this building around for another 100 or 200 years.
And as for the rest of the half a block lot, Fagg says their initial ideas include either condos or apartments with underground parking. The state of Montana saw record high graduation rates in 2018. The Office of Public Instruction reports the four-year graduation rate for the 2017-18 school year was 86.4%. That's the highest rate since 2011, when the school changed its method to calculate graduation rates. American Indian students also achieved record high graduation in 2018. With a statewide average of 67.6%. Well, before we take a break, a new smartphone app is giving moms and dads the upper hand, forcing kids to reply to texts from their parents ASAP. CBS's Terry Okita has the story.
British teenager Ben Herbert was never in a rush to text his dad back. Now, he has no choice. That alarm is part of an app his dad created after Ben ignored him too many times.
He may prioritize his friends' messages over mine sometimes.
The Reply ASAP app makes missing a message impossible, taking over the screen and sounding an alarm until the user responds. You can hit snooze, but the alert will just keep coming back.
It could be annoying, but on the flip side, it's important.
Nick Herbert launched the Android app 18 months ago and says more than 100,000 people have downloaded it.
That's great. That's great. I wish they had have had it, you know, 10 years ago.
Yeah, I don't normally reply to people a lot on time, so if it is like something that would like force me into it, it'd be good.
Herbert acknowledges some people may find the technology intrusive, but says it has actually improved his relationship with his son.
From a safety perspective, if I send him a message, it will tell me where he is at the time that the message arrives on his phone.
Each user needs to download the app for it to work. Ben says he doesn't mind the check-ins. He keeps tabs on his dad, too.
I have used it on him for, like, some important situations.
Ben's dad says he doesn't bombard his son with lots of texts, only urgent ones.
Like, I was out with my mates at a football match, and I was out later than I was meant to be.
This father and son never dreamed their experience would better connect so many other families. Terry Okita, CBS News, London.
So far, the app is only available for Android users. Apple has so far rejected it because of its location and sound features. Nick Herbert says he will continue to make changes to the iPhone version until it's approved.